Hello and good morning, everyone. I can see participants trickling in. We'll get started in just a minute more. Okay, we'll get started in the interest of time. Hello all, good morning. Participants joining us from APAC, good afternoon. Thanks for joining us for this exciting session. We have registrations from six countries today: Singapore, Amsterdam, the Netherlands, Hong Kong, Bogota, US, and Mexico. I hope all of us are able to make it today on time. We have an exciting topic and even more exciting speaker for today's webinar. We will focus on leading innovation in the digital age, and Professor Rishikesha Krishnan is with us today. He's an author, columnist, and professor of management who focuses on strategy, innovation, and education. He is listed in the Thinkers 50 India list for the most influential management thinkers from India. He is an author. His book, 8 Steps to Innovation, Going from Jugaad to Excellence, is a top seller. And his earlier book, The Challenge for India, proposed, that is From Jugaad to Systematic Innovation, The Challenge for India, proposed a blueprint for how India can enhance its innovation output. He is currently working at IIM Bangalore, and earlier he served as the director at IIM Indore. Welcome, Professor Rishikesha Krishnan. Happy to have you here, and over to you.
A lot, Rajiv. It's really good to be on this webinar. Greetings to all the participants. I'm going to essentially share with you some ideas on how leading innovation in the digital era is a little different from how it was before. I've been working in the field of innovation management now for about almost 25 years. And for a long time, we had a pretty clear idea of what it takes to drive innovation in companies. But in recent years, the advent of digital technologies has made us rethink what does it really take to make innovation happen in an organization. So that's going to be the focus of my presentation today. Essentially, I'm going to focus on 8 points on how leading innovation is different in the digital era. These are summarized in the slide, which you should be able to see right now. Just very quickly, the first important point is that the entire scope for innovation is increasing at a very rapid pace. The second important point is that data has become critical, and it is increasingly becoming a substitute for customer immersion. And I'll explain how that is the case very soon. The third important point, oops, I think I did something funny. One second. The third important point is that experimentation has become much easier, but it's also become much more critical for companies. So experimentation is something that all companies need to focus on, and I will explain to you what that means. The fourth important dimension about how leading innovation is different in the digital era is that open innovation has become even more important, but with some caveats. It needs strategic design, and increasingly it involves a focus on startups. Not only is open innovation about working with startups, it's also about strategic experimentation through collaborative platforms. And that's going to be the fifth point I will focus on. The sixth challenge I see in managing innovation in the digital era is that capturing value out of innovation is becoming much more challenging. The changes are much more rapid, and traditional ways of capturing innovation like intellectual property protection are not working that well. The seventh point is that clearly in most companies, the shift of innovation is happening away from traditional approaches and domains to the emerging domains of artificial intelligence and machine learning. In a way, this is inevitable, but I'm also going to argue that this is risky, and companies might like to look at some precautions they need to take in this regard. Finally, the important point which caps all of these other changes is that the role of the leader is now changing. The role of the leader is increasingly that of being the chief experimenter, not just a decision maker. So these are the 8 themes I'm going to focus on how leading innovation is different in the digital era. Let me start with the first one. I think clearly digital technologies have broadened the scope of innovation. Whether you look at first the kind of products that could be digitized, which completely changed the nature of innovation in music, books, movies, etc. But now it's not just restricted to things that could be digitized themselves. Thanks to sensors and IoT, machines and devices have also become quasi-digital. So that's expanded the scope in many ways. Services have not remained immune to this. And we have several examples across the financial services sector. You can see, for example, that earlier we had to make rough estimates of car insurance premium based on a whole lot of proxies. But today we can put a sensor in the car, measure driver behavior, and calculate a much more accurate premium based on the driver's behavior. Once you add artificial intelligence and machine learning to this mix, clearly the scope of innovation broadens even further. Because now we are talking about embedded intelligence, we are talking about self-learning, we are talking about better alignment and customization with customer needs. So that really broadens the scope of innovation. And of course, things like robotic process automation, AI and ML are also transforming processes. So it's not only about products. Many of the processes that happen in the background where traditionally a lot of the innovation has happened, for example, in manufacturing or in services delivery, these new technologies are essentially removing some of the trade-offs we used to see between, for example, earlier we used to think that low cost depended on skill. That may no longer be the case. One of the most important things about artificial intelligence, and this has been observed by people who have done research in this area, is that it's driving innovation on two dimensions. It is, first of all, more like a general purpose technology, like a motor or a microprocessor that can be applied across sectors. And it's also a method of invention. So it's like digital computing. It's helping you completely redefine problems, automate discovery, change the playbook. So in many ways, AI has made a significant difference to the nature of innovation itself. So if you look at this chart, when you combine both, when you have a technology that's both a method of invention as well as a sort of foundation technology for multiple products and processes, that's really a very significant jump in the kind of innovation you can do. Just to give you an example, I'm talking about a startup in India that's recently been doing quite well. It's a startup called Niramai, which works in the area of screening people for breast cancer. The problem is very well known. Breast cancer is the top cause of cancer deaths in women. For example, in India itself, we have about 150,000 women a year who are afflicted with breast cancer. And the survival rates are actually quite low. It could be as low as 50%. Early diagnosis is known to be critical to decrease mortality. But for a lot of traditional reasons, things like privacy, women's reluctance to actually go to a doctor and have an examination, these have prevented breast cancer from getting detected early enough. So what do you do? Well, the Niramai approach is to use a method which is much less dangerous, much less invasive, essentially use thermal image processing to enable the breast cancer detection at a much earlier stage. And this is possible today because of machine learning algorithms which facilitate reliable and accurate screening. So this is a good example of where AI is actually being used both as a new method of invention and as a new technology to drive innovation in ways that were not possible before, and thereby enabling something to be done at much lower cost with more accuracy and, of course, overcoming some serious societal challenges. Just to go back to what I was talking about, there are other ways in which the scope of innovation has broadened. We live in an experience economy, whether you're talking about an Ola or an Uber cab or an Oyo or maybe Airbnb kind of accommodation. There's convenience and, of course, additional methods of providing convenience like bots, augmented reality, virtual reality, etc. Business model innovation has certainly seen huge leaps in the internet and digital era, though one must also caution at the same time that there are serious challenges in sustainability. And that's reflected in some of the huge losses we see in some of the internet companies, in spite of their otherwise apparent success. they seem to be struggling to find the right business model, which will enable them to grow profitably. The last important dimension of the scope of innovation is what's happening to innovation within the organization. We talk a lot about automation, but what people are increasingly talking about is the need to change the human-machine relationship in order to augment automation with the human element. So BCG recently came out with this report on the company of the future, and you can see right at the middle of their framework is an item called Reconceive the Human-Machine Relationship. This essentially means relooking at the way we design organizations, the way we design the human-machine interface, what kind of skills we are looking for, a whole lot of things related to that. So that's sort of completes the first point. Let me now go on to the other ways in which leading innovation is changing in the digital era. In his introduction, Rajiv mentioned a couple of books that I had the pleasure of writing. One of the books we wrote in 2013 was called 8 Steps to Innovation, Going from Jugaad to Excellence. In this book, we identified the key challenges organizations face in building systematic innovation capabilities. That is the ability to innovate on a sort of continuing basis. So one of the questions we've been thinking about quite a lot is how does the digital era or the digital domain change the priorities as far as building a systematic innovation capability is concerned? Do the processes remain the same or are the processes different? If they are different, how are they different? So this is what I'm going to be addressing in the next few points. So when we were writing the book on 8 Steps to Innovation, one of the things we focused on was the importance of building what we call a challenge book. A challenge book is essentially identifying those problems which the company should be working on using innovation. And one of the core ideas we had in building the challenge book is that you need to immerse yourself in the lives of customers. That really helps you understand their needs better and identify what are the kind of products or services you should be building. But what's interesting is that in the data-driven era we live today, a lot of understanding of customers can actually be done through data. And the old physical immersion which you required may no longer be that relevant. One company that's doing a great job of data-driven customer need identification and customer product definition is Bajaj FinServ, which is a leading financial services company in India. They have issued more than 15 million EMI cards to customers. This enables them to sort of track customer spending and their repayment. And they also get data from credit agencies like Equifax. They are now pooling all this data together. And as a result, they're able to understand the credit needs of customers, proactively offer credit products to them, and their recovery rates are actually very good. So Bajaj FinServ and its parent company, Bajaj Finance, are today one of the most highly valued finance companies in India. So their strength is coming from their ability to use data to design the right products which suit the needs of customers and manage risk for the company at the same time. The second important difference we saw in what we had studied earlier as far as building innovation processes is concerned is the essentiality of experimentation. Now, we argued in our book that experimentation is important, but we also realized that experimentation was not always easy for a number of reasons, fear of failure, the cost of experimentation, and so on. But in the digital era, experimentation has become almost imperative. Just think of a company like Google. When they want to figure out how to improve their search engine, do they sit down with customer focus groups to discuss the search engine experience? Do they convene an internal committee to vote on which new feature they should implement? They don't really do all that. What they're doing is constantly experimenting, testing lots of new ideas, measuring customer response, and then building on that to add new features to their search engine. So what this really suggests is that in the digital era, experimentation has become much less expensive, it takes much less time, and it's also become almost essential. What's important in this context is that we should be aware of two different types of experiments. One is the convergent type of experiment where we are testing. Should we offer feature A or feature B? This is a much more formal scientific experimental design. You ask a precise question, you try to provide an answer, so it involves very rigorous testing. And there's the divergent type of experiment where you put a prototype in the hands of customers, you pose them a kind of open set of questions, and you try and see how they use the product when they are given that kind of an open-ended opportunity. So the key message we have from contemporary understanding of experimentation is that to innovate successfully, you need both convergent and divergent experiments, and that these are needed at different stages and in different parts of your business. So as David Rogers writes in his book on the digital transformation playbook, successful innovation needs to balance both exploratory learning to generate and develop new ideas and confirmatory learning to verify and refine ideas. Once you get these right, you actually have a huge opportunity to also cut the entire innovation cycle time. As this chart shows you, the traditional innovation cycle rapidly contracts into a much shorter cycle when you start innovating by rapid experimentation. This only underlines the importance of experimentation in driving innovation in the digital era. Just look at this quote from the CIO of Intuit, where she says, we can run 50 different ideas through our rapid experimentation process in the time and resources it takes to run 3 ideas through our old process. Coming to the fourth important insight, and the third one in terms of the process, open innovation looks to be much more important than it was before, but there's a caveat. It needs to be strategically designed and it needs to have a startup focus. What do we see as the advantages of open innovation? Clearly, it allows you to tap into a whole new set of people who might have exciting ideas. NASA ran this International Space Challenge, Space Station Challenge a few years ago, where they got ideas from people on how to develop a complex algorithm to allow NASA to position the solar collectors on the International Space Station to generate as much power as possible in difficult orbital positions. And what they found was they actually got got algorithms which performed much better on some of the edge cases. The resulting algorithm compared quite favorably with the current tools they had, but could be developed at a fraction of the price. So there was cost saving. There was a opportunity to solve the sort of edge problems much better. And of course, they got a whole new set of ideas which they could use. But I think it's important to be clear about a few things on how do you do open innovation effectively? What's the sort of right way to do it? The first thing is to define the problem well and not leave it open-ended. Generally, open innovation works much better when the challenge is well-defined. Second, you need clear metrics for evaluation. In fact, in the example I gave you just now, NASA had to build a separate model to evaluate the entries. You also need to design the challenge well. The prize money has to be right. So does the length of the contest. Issues of ownership of IP need to be clear. Protection of confidential data has to be ensured. And the criteria and the process for selection of winners should be transparent. Ultimately, of course, you need to address organizational challenges. There tends to be a not invented here syndrome within most organizations. So if you want open innovation to work, you have to make sure you have an organization internally that's open to accepting ideas from outside. But clearly, another important caveat of open innovation today is that the new frontier is collaborating with startups. Startups have a lot of the new and smart ideas, particularly in the digital space. So you have a whole variety of companies looking at creative ways to collaborate with startups. For example, Cisco runs a program called Launchpad in India, where they work with 10 startups in each cohort. But the startups are carefully chosen. They are those which are working on technologies or products that are either complementary to Cisco's products or can go into complex systems in which Cisco may be involved. For example, smart cities. So a couple of the companies they worked with in their recent cycle of Launchpad were both involved in the smart city program. Experimentation, I mentioned earlier, as important, but there's another dimension of experimentation which forms part of our insight number 5. That is strategic experimentation through collaborative platforms. Increasingly, we are finding in the digital platform economy, it's important for companies to create platforms with partners in other industries, sometimes even with competitors, in order to drive network economies and platform effects. This means the top management of the company has to be open to continuously looking for opportunities for such collaboration. For example, the Ford Motor Company some years ago created platforms to experiment on car sharing, car swap, social shuttle buses, parking space location, etc. These often involve considerable investments and they involve collaboration with a wide variety of partners. That's why this needs to be driven carefully from the top and aligned with the strategy of the company. The sixth important insight I would like to share from you today, as far as how innovation is changing in the digital era, is some of the challenges regarding capturing value from innovation. Traditionally, we looked at capturing value in simple frameworks like the one I'm putting up before you now, which basically talked about the importance of complementary resources in making money. But what's happening today is that this whole situation is changing quite a bit. Take the case of Gillette. Gillette traditionally has been a company which is quite innovative. It's come up with very successful shaving products like the Mark III razor, which I'm showing you in this picture. And the Mark III razor was covered by as many as 57 patents. So one set of protection came from the IP surrounding the product. The other came from the complementary assets they had, from sales, branding, marketing, distribution, the whole gamut of different value chain activities that Gillette did much better than anyone else. How is all this changing now? Well, you look at this company called the Dollar Shave Club. The Dollar Shave Club was acquired, I think, about a year ago by Unilever for $1 billion. This is a digital era shaving company, which essentially sends out samples, gets feedback from customers based on feedback, sends fresh samples, then they send out the product at regular intervals, and it's all done through a digital interface. So you don't really need to order a product. You get a customized shaving solution to meet your specific needs, and all of this is driven through digital technology. So this digital change essentially almost from nowhere created a competitor to Gillette. And that competitor, of course, became much more potent when a strong competitor like Unilever bought the Dollar Shave Club, and today is in that space. So all the complementary assets and IP which Gillette used as protection for many years proved to be, well, I'm not saying it's inadequate, but certainly it didn't stop the Dollar Shaving Club from becoming a serious player in that same space. Another important dimension which I would bring to all the attention of all of you is that with the importance of data, there are new challenges coming up. For example, we talked about AI earlier in the discussion. Now, AI, of course, uses a lot of data. And if you're in a B2C space, it probably uses a lot of personal data. But we also know that regulation is beginning to catch up with uses of data. For example, the European Union's GDPR has come out with norms on what you need to do if you're using AI inside your service or product in some kind of a black box. They're insisting on four things: on transparency, accountability, the data subject needs to be in control, and data minimization policies should be followed. So you need to collect the minimum data which the customer needs to share. So these kind of principles are going to start questioning at some level the ways you collect data, the kind of data you store. So I did argue earlier that data is a substitute for customer immersion, but at the same time, regulatory constraints are going to be placed on what kind of data you can collect and how you use that. Look at India's draft e-commerce policy, which was announced earlier this year. It's got some very interesting and I think quite challenging provisions. For example, they're saying that derivative data developed by companies can potentially be entrusted to the state, that the government has to have access to data and proprietary algorithms. So if this is the kind of policy which actually comes into force, this would of course place quite seriously challenges to companies in terms of how they are using data to innovate. I'm going towards the end. There are 2 points left. The seventh key insight on how leading innovation is changing is on the shift from traditional innovation domains to new domains like artificial intelligence and machine learning. It looks like that's inevitable. I mean, the focus of innovation today in most companies is data analytics and AI. R&D in traditional major disciplines is going on the back burner, but there are serious challenges. I am sure many of you are acquainted with those. For example, well-qualified and capable innovators in the emerging digital disciplines are difficult to find. And the best people in AI and ML are often snapped up by the large platform players with their deep pockets. Smaller companies and traditional companies find it quite difficult to get some of the most talented AI folks. That's one dimension of the problem. But the other dimension of the problem is it possible that in this mad rush to use AI and ML, we are again focusing too narrowly and losing valuable competencies that we had developed earlier? I think that danger certainly exists, and I would caution companies to completely abandon or against completely abandoning their earlier research and putting all their money in AI and ML alone. And there was a particular challenge in AI and ML, just as a caution, because increasingly people are beginning to worry about how much of AI and ML is real AI and ML. There's this really interesting presentation I came across by a professor at Princeton a few days ago, where he's very provocatively titled, How to Recognize AI Snake Oil, where he says much of what's being sold as AI today is really snake oil. It does not and cannot work. So we need to be equally cautious about this in our corporate innovation context. The last insight I wanted to share with you today is that the role of leadership in a digital era in innovation is actually changing. Earlier, many times leaders would play the role of bringing in their deep experience and intuition to back particular hunches or to get those insights which other people couldn't quite come up with. But increasingly, I think in this domain, we are seeing the role of the leader as the chief experimenter. It's more about piloting the strategic experiments of the type that I told you about Ford earlier, that Ford is doing all these platform experiments with other companies, or in terms of demanding more experimentation by members of the team of both the convergent and divergent type as appropriate. So in a way, the role of the leader is not about second guessing what people are doing or even making those intuitive decisions, but about developing, nurturing, and sustaining an experimentation culture in the organization. So that's why I believe increasingly the role of the leader is as the chief experimenter. Just to sum up once again, these are the 8 points. The scope for innovation is increasing. Data is critical. It's a substitute for customer immersion. Experimentation is easier, less expensive, but certainly essential. Open innovation is important with a strategic design and a startup focus. Strategic experimentation needs to complement open innovation and be done through collaborative platforms. Value capture is becoming more challenging. You need to move faster to ensure that you can capture value, and some of the other issues like data security and data regulation are also going to make this process more challenging in the future. Many companies are shifting from domain-related R&D to AI and ML. That's inevitable. But I think one also needs to be cautious. Make sure you're doing real AI, not the kind of snake oil which some people have identified. And at the same time, you're not putting all your eggs in the AI basket. And the role of the leader is now that of a chief experimenter, not an intuitive decision maker. So these are the 8 ways in which I think leading innovation in the digital era is different from leading innovation before. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Professor, for sharing your insights on leading innovation in the digital era. So now we'll open this up for Q&A. Feel free to post your questions on the Q&A box here or on the chat channel. Happy to moderate the questions that come our way. But I'll kick this off with a few questions from my end. So at KNOLSKAPE, we focus on something called clearing the digital blur, starting with a definition of what digital even means, right? Because it could mean pretty much anything or nothing, right? There's a lack of clear understanding of what this means. And in the BLUR acronym we have, U stands for unbounded innovation, which is earlier in the industrial era, innovation was pretty much product focused or maybe process focused. Today, you're moving from products to ecosystems where you need to go beyond your organizational capabilities and think about what's happening in the ecosystem. So the question I have is, you know, how do you strike this balance between focus or focused innovation and this expansive innovation? Because it seems like companies like Apple or Uber, they have this philosophy of being lean at the core and expanding at the periphery, right? If you think about what Apple does, they've gotten a Play Store, which is lean at the core, but they are expanding into multiple industries. And today it's very difficult to slot Google or Amazon into one industry. Their tentacles are everywhere. Yeah. So how do you strike this balance between focus and expansive mindset?
I think what's happening is that the nature of growth and diversification is changing in the digital era we live in. Now, earlier we used to think that the way to grow is to have this core competence and then to use this core competence to go into new areas. Today, the way many companies are looking at growth is quite different. They're saying that I already have this network of customers. I've already created this ecosystem. What else can I do to now meet the needs of the ecosystem? So that's increasingly becoming the bigger driver. And the seems to be a shift saying I can build all the other products and capabilities needed to meet the need of that ecosystem if I already have that ecosystem closely tied to me, whether I'm an Amazon or a Google or a Facebook. So I think one of the big challenges for companies who came from a more traditional approach is how do you start looking in this direction? And it's not as though companies don't have ecosystems and networks, yeah, but they don't look at them that way. Yeah. I mean, just give me take a simple example of a bank. Most banks have, you know, huge customer base. They're sitting on a lot of data of the customers, but they don't look at that customer as a network or ecosystem and how they could provide a wider range of services. So I think it's an interesting question you asked. I think it's a lot of it has to do with how do you look at this whole question of growth and diversification.
Great. Wonderful. So still awaiting questions from the audience here. Please feel free to post questions in the Q&A box or on the chat window. So I'll go for it again, the second question. So from our interaction with companies that are going through digital transformation and picking up on your point on what to focus on, right? So some companies use the customer journey map instead of looking at the world through the product lens. Now they are starting to look at innovation through the customer lens. So that's one source of new innovative ideas. The next one is redefining the mission of the organization itself. So when we work with a bank, some of them come to the realization that the word bank doesn't mean much anymore. So the whole business model of you know, getting deposits and issuing loans and the making your margins and interest and spread and all of that is passé, right? So we're not a bank, we are actually a lifestyle partner. So it's a restatement of the mission itself or finding the purpose of the organization. An oil and lubricant company is saying, we are not in the business of just selling lubricants, we are in the business of removing friction wherever it exists. So that could mean an IoT device tomorrow that sort of predicts friction, not just removing friction through oil. So from your research, you know, one thing is to look at customer journey maps. The other one is to really find your purpose and restate the mission. Can you throw more light on this? How do organizations deal with this?
That's a fascinating question. Of course, this issue is not completely new because those of you who had done marketing in life might know there is a professor called Theodore Levitt who many, many years ago wrote an article on, you know, basically trying to understand what business you're in. And if you just go back to that very basic question, it covers many of the issues you are talking about now. So, I mean, you could very clearly see, for example, that you might be selling cars, but what you're actually doing is providing mobility. So even earlier, you could have looked at your mission quite differently. I think this ties in a little bit with what I was speaking about earlier, that earlier the constraint in looking at your mission more broadly was how do I possibly go into something that I don't know too much about. So if, for example, today mobility is more about the mobile phone than necessarily about the cab, how do you make the shift, or how do you, you know, integrate those two together? So I think that's where perhaps today this whole digital revolution is providing the kind of glue which enables you to sort of move from one to another. That's why in most domains today, existing companies fear the entry of the digital giants the most, because they feel the digital giants could very easily move into their space. So, but I think it's really, I think the issue itself is extremely challenging. Also realize that there are other sort of barriers as well. We talked a little bit about a bank. If you look at a bank, one of the biggest issues is regulation. I mean, banks today probably continue to exist the way they do only because of regulation. If regulation of banking and financial services was to be lowered, you would have a flood of other players taking over a lot of the banking industry. So I think the trigger, or the thing which is really going to change this, is if, I mean, it's a big if, but if regulation changes, then you might see a lot of that happening. Yeah, minus that, I don't think there is really that urgency to look at the mission that closely. I actually, it's interesting that you mentioned that, because I attended a strategy workshop of one of India's big banks about 7-8 months ago. They were really struggling with these issues. It wasn't easy at all for them to get out of that traditional thought process of what a bank does. And they could see the value of the network, but beyond that, it was very difficult for them to imagine doing their business in a different way.
Sure. Great. So we've got a couple of questions. So Padma Kumar has a question. Having an innovation group within the company versus having a separate company that focuses on innovation without any production sales function, which one is better, and in which context do you think these models work well?
I think this is a question which people have struggled with for a long time. I mean, I'm not sure it has an easy answer, but I have a few views on this.
The first view is that I don't think innovation should be seen as just one person's responsibility. So some companies have this idea, let's have a chief innovation officer. I'm not sure, it can work for a short time, but it's not a good long-term solution. The second issue is this, should I have it outside the company? Should I have it outside the company? I think the rationale for having something outside is significant only if it's going to get squashed by being inside. So if its work is going to come so much in conflict with the existing business, so the business might squash it and prevent it from doing its stuff, then maybe you need to separate it. But otherwise, it's better to have it inside, because ultimately it has to get integrated with the operations of the company. If the innovation doesn't get integrated, it's not going to have any impact on the business. I think Krishnan talked about this a lot in his book on the innovator's dilemma. So if it's really disruptive and it's going to challenge the existing business, keep it outside, because otherwise it might be prevented from doing its work. And otherwise, better to keep it outside.
Right? Okay. All right, so there's one more question. What is the difference between open innovation and innovation through collaboration?
Yeah, so there are a lot of these terms. Open innovation essentially is a broad umbrella term. It refers to the simple phenomenon of companies not restricting their innovation efforts to what they are doing internally. So open innovation could involve running challenge contests.
It could involve external partnerships. It could involve working with academia.
It could work with research institutes. It could be a whole gamut of this. I spoke specifically a little more about the challenge contest part and the startup interaction. But open innovation is really anything you're doing in innovation, which is outside the boundaries of the organization.
Okay, great. All right. So the next question is from Ranjit. So his question is, boring company, SpaceX, Tesla, so all these are Elon Musk companies, right? How will they justify their innovation to a shareholder? Aren't they too risky a proposition? So just to add a little bit of a layer on top of this is a question I wanted to ask as well. So some of these digital native companies seem to embrace what is called as permissionless innovation, right? And maybe breaking a few laws and regulations in the process versus precautionary innovation that many publicly listed companies are forced to follow. So there is an uneven playing ground, so to speak, right? So from a shareholder perspective, how does this look?
Many of these companies are not shy at all about what is their strategy. And let me just rewind a bit. I mean, of course, it's fashionable to talk about Elon Musk today, but you go back to Google's IPO prospectus. In Google's IPO prospectus, Brin and Page very clearly said upfront that from time to time we are going to do crazy things, and you don't be surprised if that happens. I don't know the exact words, but something to that effect was written in their prospectus. So I don't think these guys are at all shy about the approach they are taking. Now, how do they justify it to shareholders? That's let's take the example that was given. Let's take Tesla, for example. I think Tesla has had lots of ups and downs. At one time, it was more about at the concept level itself. But at some time, the whole thing shifted because ultimately people said Tesla has to have a commercial product. So we need to see a car that actually can be mass produced and can be sold in large numbers. So one of the big milestones in recent years was, can you actually have a large volume car on the road? And Tesla has struggled with some of those challenges in productionizing product. And I think valuations have also gone up and down a little bit in sync with that. So it's not as though investors are completely immune to that. And I think in general, there are moments of irrational exuberance, but then ultimately things will come back again. We're beginning to see that more.
Yes,
in the startup
correction.
Space.
Yes.
In the startup space. So, of course, these guys, one of the ways they're able to justify their huge valuations is by talking up their innovation, right? So you look at Elon Musk, he's constantly coming up with the next crazy idea. And one day maybe somebody will call his bluff, but till then, he manages to keep this flow of ideas, and one or two of them have made some progress, so there's some credibility.
Yeah. There seems to be a lot of expectation setting going on here, right? So back in the 90s, Jeff Bezos said profitability is a foolish metric, and he got away with that with his shareholders. And more recently with Uber, a week before their IPO, their CEO said, we will never ever become profitable. Gets away with that. More traditional CEOs, I think, have trouble saying something like this, that to the market. So question from Pratima, last couple of questions, being mindful of the time as well. What is the solution towards innovation in smaller organizations where there's a trade-off between addressing the bread and butter projects versus the need to innovate, especially in good times where there are ample bread and butter projects?
I don't know what exactly you mean by bread and butter projects. But
business as usual.
Yeah, but I think there are a few things you can take for granted. One thing you can take for granted is that almost any company to survive in the long run needs incremental innovation. Even the largest companies, which sometimes don't do very radical stuff, they certainly do a whole lot of incremental innovation to make sure that their efficiency and productivity is continuously improving. I think if you don't do that, you're going to be in trouble very soon, whichever way. So I think there's no substitute for that. Perhaps the more important question is, do you really need to take big bets? There, I would say the jury is a little bit out. It depends on whether you want to make big leaps. Sometimes to make big leaps, you need to take big bets. But there are companies which for extended periods of time have not taken very big bets. But they have been relentlessly efficient on the productivity side. So whether you take Toyota in the pre-Prius era, or you take Southwest Airlines in the airline industry, all these guys are extremely focused on making those continuous improvements, which ensure that they retain operational efficiency. I think if If you don't do that, I would say you're in fairly big trouble. Then you all this.
Great. Final question. So KNOLSKAPE does a lot of work on the leadership side, behavioral side, building, you know, mindsets and behaviors for the digital age. And this question is quite in line with this. What are three key behavioral characteristics that a leader as a chief experimenter should demonstrate?
Yeah, that's a great question. So I think the first characteristic is not something entirely new, but you need to be a good listener, because you have to listen to the data, listen to the evidence that comes in, be willing to examine it. So I think you need to be a good listener would be the first important thing I would underline. You need to be willing to be process driven, because I've known CEOs who insist on the data and everything being processed through the process before they will take a final decision, because they want to get that process rigor into the company. That rigor is important, because as I mentioned in the presentation, a lot of those convergent experiments actually depend on A versus B kind of decisions. They depend on your rigorously analyzing the data. So I would say that your willingness to be process driven is a second important characteristic for that. And I guess the third is, it's related to that. You've got to be open to things coming from below, because it's not going to happen just because you're the CEO and all that. If your role is now the chief experimenter, you have to be, you know, much more open to ideas coming from below and much more receptive. So it's in a way, all the things I said are related to, you know, each other. You need to be receptive, good listener, you need to be process driven. I think these are all kind of complementary to each other in creating that really strong ability to make data driven kind of decisions.
Great. Thank you so much, Professor. It was wonderful listening to your insights. I hope all of you got a lot of benefit from attending this. So once again, thank you so much for your time. And a request from my end, please follow us on Twitter, on LinkedIn, on other social media platforms. This is our way of reaching out to you for our future webinars as well. So thank you so much for your time and attention, and we will stay in touch. Thank you so much.
Thank you.